Welcome to another of the Why Study series of the Department of Theology and Religious Studies. With me today is Dr. Simon Oliver, who teaches systematic theology and is a very eminent theologian in his own right. Simon, why study systematic theology?
Well, I should probably say something about what systematic theology is, to start with. And the word systematic feels a little daunting, systematic theology as opposed to unsystematic or chaotic theology. Well, systematic theology implies a system and an order. And I suppose in its most formal sense, systematic theology is concerned with the different aspects of Christian theology, of Christian teaching, and the way that they fit together and the way that they help to explain each other. So we have different areas. For example, Christology is the study of the person and work of Jesus Christ, ecclesiology, the study of the church, pneumatology is the study of the person of the Holy Spirit, and we take each aspect of Christian theology to understand how one can help us explain the other, and so on and so forth, to try and map it into some sort of system in that rather formal sense. Now, of course, the Christian tradition is itself very complex in its 2,000-year history. Different teachings get understood in very different ways. So actually, in practice, systematic theology can be a very intricate but rather messy and unsystematic affair.
Okay, we live in a very secular Europe, and we're told that it's becoming more secular all the time. In such a context, why study systematic theology?
Gosh, well, I imagine that that is a question that a lot of people will think of when they hear the word theology and they hear the word Christianity. But what lies behind a question like that, this idea that Europe is secular, is an idea of what secularism is and what it means. And the story would run something like this, that from around the 16th, 17th century, we have the rise of modern science, we have the rise of rationalism, what's sometimes called the Enlightenment, and the modern world. And this involves the rolling back of a religious imagination and a religious way of understanding things and a Christian way of understanding things. And the idea is that as you roll back that territory, as you demythologize, as some people say, what you end up with is a neutral ground that appeals only to rationality, to pure reason, and particularly to the hard sciences. Now, a lot of historians of Christianity and a lot of Christian theologians make the argument that when you roll things back like that, what you're left with is not a neutral sphere at all. What you're left with is competing pseudo-theologies. So if theology is about our highest aspirations, our most important commitments, our deepest desires in some sense, things that transcend the ordinary and the everyday, the idea is that what comes in with secularization is new priorities, new highest aspirations, new commitments and new forms of reason. And within that, Christian theology still has a very important argument to make about the kinds of commitments that the Christian tradition has and the kinds of reason that it offers. So it's not a neutral, clear space, but it is one where there are still theological arguments going on. Even if one is a committed atheist, that's still a theological position, and it's still one that we need to discuss. And coupled to that, we must also remember, I think, that so many of the categories that we live with, categories of freedom, of justice, of simple right and wrong, of our understanding of God, even if we reject a belief in God, we still have an understanding of what we're rejecting. So many of those categories come from the Christian tradition, from our historical inheritance. And so it's absolutely crucial that we study that tradition and we study that form of reason.
Yeah, okay, we study it. But is there a sense in which when every age likes to claim that it's the modern age, mm-hmm. and every age likes to claim that it has an insight that is unique and that is somehow better. Mm-hmm. Tell me, why is that? Why can I not just say, I've got a better insight. I live in the brightness of the early 21st century.
Right. Well, again, that reflects a commitment to a certain view of history, namely one of progress. So simply what we have now is better than what we had in the past, that we march forward. Now, of course, in certain respects, that is absolutely true. We have made enormous strides in medicine and science and technology. But the question is, have any of those developments made us any wiser? Have they made us any more savvy? Have they solved some of our most fundamental and perplexing problems about human identity, about right and wrong, about how to live in community, about whether the universe, for example, has any intrinsic meaning, whether it points beyond itself to something beyond, to something that the Christian tradition has called God. So, despite our progress, it's not entirely clear that we've become any wiser and better at answering those fundamental questions. And a lot of theologians would say that answers that were given in the past by different generations are in fact clearer or nearer the mark than some modern ideas that we have now philosophically and theologically. And it's therefore very important to go back to those sources and see what they can teach us.
One of the things that I find is that when I'm talking to a theologian like you, the model of what it means to understand is a very much a relational model. It's how I relate to society, how I relate mm-hmm. to meaning. But when I'm talking to other scholars, not theologians, often the model of understanding is it's almost like collecting stamps and gathering information and arranging information in a... The computer becomes the model. Is there a difference the way theologians think and the way we imagine a computer to think?
Right, okay. Well, this again represents quite a dramatic shift from the way that humans went about their intellectual inquiry in centuries past and the way that they have done more recently. So the kinds of sources that we read historically are often written in the form of dialogue. So Plato, the ancient Greek philosopher, writes in a dialogue. St. Thomas Aquinas, who I study, a 13th century theologian, writes all his work not in a monologue form, but as it would have happened in a conversation in a seminar in the University of Paris, for example. And all the time, learning belongs within a community, within, between people, conversationally, because we teach each other. It's as simple as that. We teach each other and we learn by conversation, by sharing ideas. It's a simple idea, two brains are better than one. It's as simple as that. But then we get, in the modern period, in the 17th century, for example, a philosopher, Frenchman, René Descartes, who goes away on his own to think on his own, in isolation, to doubt everything, to try and find one piece of very certain knowledge, and he comes up with the one piece of certain knowledge, I think, therefore I am, cogito ergo sum. I think, therefore I am. This is an individual on his own. And we get the idea for the first time of the lone scholar, the lone investigator. Isaac Newton, the great 17th century scientist, works very much in isolation on his own. This is the lone genius. And this is a very different understanding of the human intellectual enterprise. And one that's quite alien to the way that Christianity and Christian theology and Christian philosophy have understood their project, if you like.
When you say that you contrast the lone genius to the dialogue of Plato, is it significant that theology down the centuries has been done in communities? It's argument among churches. It takes place almost in the coffee room more often than in the library.
Very much so, partly because of this idea that as different viewpoints collide, they in turn change themselves and produce new insights. So providing fora where ideas can come together can be enormously fruitful and generative. And this is why we have, for example, departments of theology and religious studies such as we have at the University of Nottingham, where scholars and students can come together in fruitful dialogue as part of this theological exercise.
Now, you've only got 30 seconds. Someone wants to read something or to start doing systematic theology. What do they do?
They read St. Anselm's Proslogion, which was written in the 11th century. It's very short. It contains supposedly a definitive proof of God's existence, but it's actually written as a prayer. And the reason that text is so important is that it demonstrates the way that theologians are very careful what they say and how they use the word God. And so often today, we think it's very straightforward what we mean by that word, and Anselm teaches us a very fundamental lesson of Christian theology, and that's that we should be very careful what we say in the presence of Almighty God and how we use that word.
Simon Oliver, thank you very much. This is the view of one theologian on how to do theology, and you can see him actually doing some theology in this interview. Good luck with your work.